with a PID number so that when we come back, we can go and find these animals again. And so here is Claudio, a colleague of ours, taking blood together with a park ranger. This is an example of the terrain in which they were working, which is pretty hard, especially when you go up on the slopes and the tortoises that are around. And I wanted to give you an example. I mean, Lonesome Georgia, both Lonesome Georgia and the species from Floreana are the saddleback tortoises. And the endemic species from Volcano Wolf is actually domed. So we were very excited when we found individuals on Volcano Wolf with this really pronounced saddlebacks and yellow faces, which are typical of the saddleback morph of tortoises, which means these animals are very likely to be hybrids of some sort, either with the species from Pinta or the species from Floreana. And so now we are busy analyzing these 1,600 samples that we found. And the idea is when we identify the individuals of conservation interest, we go back to Volcano Wolf, probably not this summer, but the next summer, and we find these animals and we bring them in at the Charles Darwin Station where they start breeding them. And they can do this breeding very well. They have breeding programs for tortoises for the past 20 years. This is a little Galapagos tortoise hatchling. What they do, as I told you, they incubate. When they find the eggs, they take the they have the tortoises in enclosures. The females lay the eggs. Then people go get the eggs and put them in two distinct incubators at two different temperatures. They have 1 degree difference. And one temperature will be hatching in females, the other one in males. Here is some tortoises hatching.
Which one requires a higher temperature, male or female?
The female. And here is the breeding center in the Galapagos. They have these pens where after the little tortoises arrive, I mean, they hatch, they are this size, that they keep them in these enclosures here that are protected so that the Galapagos ox doesn't go and, or the rats also, there are some, these are for the ox and there are some webs, some mesh to avoid that the rats will eat them. Each tortoise will have a number. When they grow up to a certain size, usually it's this size, which is above predation risk from either rats or ox, they put them in boxes and they bring them back to the islands where they belong to. So they're really good at doing this. Now, I couldn't resist showing a picture of my other son. This is Alessandro with my husband Jeff, doing work on the marine iguanas. We also work on marine iguanas, and he got pretty affectionate with some of the tortoises, as you can see. And I just wanted to tell you that the Galapagos tortoises represent have been an iconic symbol for the past, but they've also been inspirational for the cultural symbols of our times. In fact, I should not have clicked this now, but I did. So Steven Spielberg used them as an inspiration for E.T. Here they are. And if you want to read a little bit more about Lonesome George, there is a very nice readable book called Lonesome George by this journalist, Harry Nichols. And if you want to know a little bit more about the evolution and the science behind Galapagos, this is another book that I recommend. And with that, I'd be happy to accept any questions. The other thing I wanted to say is there is also this other book that just came out, a photographic book by a professional photographer, and has also work from all the people that work in the Galapagos on each group. So I have an article on the tortoises, people have articles on the iguanas, the sea lions, and so on and so forth. It's really, the pictures are really stunning, so if you're interested in that, that just came out 6 months ago. And I don't know if anyone of you is interested, but we are going again to a Galapagos trip organized by the Yale Alumni Association. So they asked me to put some pamphlet here if you are interested. That's it.
questions? Yeah.
Yeah. Do the tortoises float?
Yeah, they do float. And they love water. And actually, in the Indian Ocean, they have observed the tortoises floating quite often. More often, I don't know why, than the Galapagos, in the Galapagos. But there are actual reports of them being in the ocean, being probably being carried passively to the ocean after a mudslide or heavy rains. They're not going in there voluntarily, but they can survive. And actually, the long neck is also helpful. It's like a submarine.
Yeah. So they actually don't need rafts.
No, but I mean, they could do it. Yes, they could do it. With, in fact, actually, they for the Aldabra Odol is pretty interesting because the Aldabra Odol is really low. It's only 200 meters above sea level, and went completely submerged at least three times in historical times. And we have fossils that show that the tortoises, the Indian Ocean tortoise, recolonized the Aldabra Odol three times from the mainland, from either Madagascar or Africa. So it's something that, as I said before, although unlikely in any given interval of time, if you think about the long span of that you have, if you think about evolutionary time as an event that can happen, and if you arrive with a single female with eggs, then a population can start. I said before that a female usually is not even can be inseminated by multiple individuals, so you don't have also you have already a mechanism for some built-in genetic diversity that arises with a single tortoise. It's not only two individuals that start the population.
And just one other comment. You're probably aware that there were older Galapagos Islands that are now
submerged. Yeah, but our molecular
sediments.
Yeah, and in fact, they are 10 million years old, I think. And our genetic data show, I mean, it's not in contrast with, I mean, what we can say is that the genetic data that we have show that they arrived 3 to 5 million years ago, which is the age of the emerged islands. But other groups, this doesn't mean that all the animals arrived then. This is what happened for the tortoises. But for instance, for the land iguana and the marine iguana, the genetic data show that the divergence from each other happened around 18 million years ago, which probably means that this happened in an emerged in an island that now is submerged, because it's unlikely that they both they split first in South America and then they arrived both in Galapagos. So, for instance, for the iguanas, the most likely hypothesis is that they arrived much before the tortoises. Yeah.
I was poking around online, and I saw the other night a pink species of tortoise. Is that a subspecies? Is that genetic?
In Galapagos?
Yeah.
No, that was not a tortoise. It's the pink iguana called Rosada.
No, this was a pink tortoise. Okay.
I wish I would like show it to me.
I'll show it to you later.
Yeah. Not in Galapagos. It could be somewhere else.